Today will be Celine Dion Day. To fly. Oh, I'm alive. Opinion, the greatest female vocalist in the world today. That's Celine Dion. We've heard from her before. In fact, I know we played this song not too long ago, but today I decided to dedicate the entire music curriculum to her. So, good morning. This is Dr. Minarsik. This is the 58th medical school pathology session given globally. From Chicago. It's 9 a.m. in Chicago now, and it is April 3rd. Good morning again, even if it's night for you. Today, we're going to be discussing the rest of the liver topics that we started out on and finished up with largely. There's a few more to be dealt with and all of the gallbladder stuff as well. And then we're going to have a large liver lab. But I think the best thing to do right now is to do our little test and to ask you, first of all, can you hear me? I'm looking at the question box there, and I see a bunch of yeses, so I'm very happy. And then, the second question is, what do you see on your screen? Yay, flowers. Oh, and by the way, do you usually see the flowers on the screen before you even hear the music for a few minutes? Because I'm guessing that even before I start the webinar broadcast, you could probably see my screen. Okay, that's good. That means I won't be checking any of my dirty emails or anything like that before I start. Big announcement today. Big major announcement is the only thing, and I could see a couple of you have figured it out already. The reason I am giving the course again this year, even though it was pretty good last year, is because I wanted to make exquisite, high-quality videos, sound and audio. And last year was a pretty good course, but when you play back some of the streaming videos on GoPath, some of the music sounds a little bit chintzy, and it's probably okay in terms of my voice and PowerPoint, but I wanted something with phenomenal resolution. So I was able to do that this year. The problem is every one of my sessions was about 3 gigabytes. And, you know, to download 3 gigabytes just for 2 hours, that's not practical. Even for people that have high-speed internet, you don't want to spend a half of a day downloading something that only runs for 2 hours. So, finally, the big announcement is I was finally able to find a program in which I could do a 90% compression and maintain 99% quality. So if you go to my website now, medicalschoolpathology.com, you'll see I'm starting to load them up there. I have about 15 of them there already, and probably by the end of the week I'll have all 58 of them. The ironic thing is, if you were to attend this session live today, you would say, oh, well, it's pretty good quality, the music sounded okay. But if you download the archives, the MP4 compressions of my super high resolution AVIs, you're going to say, my God, the music is better, the sound is better, the video is better than what I see here from my corner of the world. And the reason why that is because I'm doing all of the recording before it goes out over the internet, before it goes to you. So I hope that you don't stop going to class because you soon realize that the movies are much higher quality than the online real-time webinars. That was the big announcement, and that's all I have to say, other than what I've already told you before. Today is Celine Dion Day. So all of the music today will be given to us by the diva, you know, one of the greatest powerful female vocalists on planet Earth right now. I guess a good place to start is where we left off. So let's go over there. And we had discussed most of the major topics about liver. We didn't go into some of the metabolic diseases and the tumors. So we'll finish that off today. And it may take 20 minutes, it may take 40 minutes, it may take 50 minutes, who knows. But when we're done with it, and that will include gallbladder diseases as well, when we're done with it, we'll then take our break, no matter when it is, whether it's 10 minutes before, 20 minutes before, or after the hour, and then we'll do our big liver lab in the second hour. And I've selected some phenomenal cases. And if you have been coming to our labs and you're starting to pick up a feel for normal tissue and diseased tissue, I think you're going to really, really enjoy this one. So I think this is where we left off on the so-called topic of metabolic liver diseases. Metabolic is a good name, a general classification for liver diseases, which are the result of faulty metabolism in the liver. Sometimes it's a case of not having an enzyme, so things accumulate. Sometimes it's a result of larger metabolic diseases like diabetes or whatnot. But I think if you were to read Robbins, and I'm sure you have, this would be the general family of the common so-called metabolic liver diseases. One of them we've talked about extensively, and that's steatosis, which is a nice word, but most people just call it fatty liver. Some people call it fatty change. Some people call it fatty metamorphosis. It's all the same thing. It's just fat in the liver. And if you remember when we had our discussion on alcoholic liver disease, we went into the biochemistry of why the fat accumulates. And we're not going to do that now. You can always go back to the chapter on environmental and nutritional. What we're going to do now is just quickly show you again something you've seen before, and I think you'll all know that this is a liver, and most of the vacuoles within the hepatocytes, and some of them are a little bit bigger than the hepatocytes, are fat, and they're fat because they look like classical fat. They wash out with xylene processing. So because most of these vacuoles are smaller than a liver cell, that would technically inherit the name microvesicular. They're small vesicles, microvesicular steatosis. Of course, in this one, which you see here, most of the vacuoles are larger than individual liver cells. So that would inherit the term macrovesicular steatosis. And once again, I'm going to give you this little quiz right now, and it's a logical thing, and it's important that you understand that. Let's say that the normal weight of a liver is 1,500 grams, okay? And let's say that this liver is twice as much. Let's say this liver is 3,000 grams. Okay, now here's the question. If you were to dissolve all of the fat out of this liver and put it into a bucket, what percentage of that 3,000 gram liver would be fat? And that's based on looking at a representative sampling or cross-section, where I'm going to ask you what percentage of this field in front of your eye is fat and what percentage is liver tissue. So you know what? Everybody's getting the right answer. They're going like somewhere in the middle. If you think that fat is about half of this slide, then the answer to the question is, if you boiled out the fat and put it into a bucket, about 1,500 grams of that 3,000 grams, you know, would be fat. Okay, we're not going to go into it extensively, but you have to also throw into the metabolic category concepts of hemochromatosis. Hemochromatosis, as you might guess, hemo being iron or blood, I don't know where the chrome come from, I guess that means color. That's iron overload disease, okay? Now, we've already talked about the word hemosiderosis, in which you have hemosiderin within the liver or within the lungs or wherever there is chronic hemorrhage. But it's different from hemochromatosis. Hemosiderosis is sort of just a process by which blood pigment breaks down somewhere in the body, in the lungs, in the liver, and deposits hemosiderin in the places where it should be. In other words, it's gobbled up by macrophages. But in hemochromatosis, the liver is actually within the parenchymal cells. So if you were to have a liver that just had hemosiderosis, you'd have a bunch of iron inside of your reticuloendothelial cells, your Kupffer cells. And you probably wouldn't have much of a functional liver disease either. But in hemochromatosis, you have liver everywhere. You have liver inside of the hepatocytes, not just the RE cells, but the hepatocytes. And in addition, hemochromatosis in the liver is regarded as leading to cirrhosis as well. So if you see a liver that has one cirrhosis, you know, the nodules and the fibrosis, and iron inside of the hepatocytes, you got your diagnosis of hemochromatosis. It could be a primary. You know, there is a gene called the HFE gene. It was discovered about 20 years ago. And mutations of the HFE gene result in hemochromatosis as a hereditary inheritable disease. And that's called primary disease. Now, in secondary disease, you have excessive iron overload, probably because of either hemolysis going on or even theoretically cases of greatly increased iron intake, which usually is not too common because the intake of iron is usually highly regulated. But sometimes if you really overload your diet with iron, you can get secondary hemochromatosis. Now, I'm going to show you a picture here. And I think First thing you're going to say is, how come this isn't H and E? Well, it's not H and E because it's a stain which we've seen many times already, called the Prussian blue stain, which stains iron. So first of all, you could see that this portal tract is pretty big, and even though it's just a little piece of the liver, you could imagine there might be some fibrosis extending this way and this way. But the liver cells surrounding this portal tract that has fibrosis have iron, not just the macrophages but the actual hepatocytes. So that's the diagnosis of hemochromatosis. There's two ways of differentiating hemochromatosis from hemosiderosis. One of them is to say hemochromatosis is hemosiderosis but with clinical disease, in other words, cirrhosis. Another way of defining it would be hemosiderin not only in the macrophages, which are supposed to gobble up the hemosiderin, but also in the parenchymal functional hepatocytes as well. Wilson's disease, we have to make a brief mention to. As you might guess, there's a Wilson's gene. It's called the Wilson disease protein gene. You can see it down here in the lecture notes. It's also known as ATP7B. Of course, you'll never remember that, and I never remember it. But in Wilson disease is a disease in which mutations of the ATP7B gene produces the bodies, not just the liver, but the brain and other areas, inability to handle copper very well, and therefore copper builds up to toxic levels. And yes, it causes cirrhosis, and yes, it causes other central nervous system symptoms as well. The one thing that is always mentioned in Wilson's disease is the so-called Kaiser-Fleischer ring. And if there is a patient in your hospital, when you go to the clinics, that has sort of a brownish ring at the limbus, in other words, the junction of the cornea and sclera, that's a Kaiser-Fleischer ring. And if there's a patient in your hospital that has Wilson's disease, or if you ever see one, there will be a million medical students running around that patient looking at their eyes just to say that they saw a Kaiser-Fleischer ring. It's a very rare thing, and Wilson's disease itself is pretty rare. So there we go. I bet you my son has seen one because he's an ophthalmologist. He probably would recognize that instantly. Okay, another couple of diseases that we have to mention as being in the so-called metabolic liver disease category is a disease called alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. Now, I want you to think of this logically. You know what trypsin is. Remember, it's a digestive enzyme that chews up proteins, okay? Well, let's say that you have an enzyme or a substance which inhibits this protease. In other words, antitrypsin, or alpha-1 antitrypsin, is a natural protease inhibitor. Okay, so antitrypsin inhibits the destructive digestive trypsin. Let's say that you have a deficiency of it. This is a pretty common disease. If you have a gene called the alpha-1 antitrypsin encoding gene, which, by the way, is on the long arm of the 14th chromosome, specifically 14Q, Q meaning the long arm, and then section 32, subsection 1. If you have a deficiency of that gene, which codes for antitrypsin, then your trypsin doesn't get regulated, and it winds up chewing up everything in sight. It's a very destructive kind of a disease. And it's not only in the liver, it's just about everywhere where it could be, and especially there's a lot of lung changes as well, resulting in chronic lung disease. Neonatal cholestasis is generally a family of diseases, and it's exactly what it is. It's seen in neonates, and it's basically cholestasis, or the impaired excretion of conjugated bilirubin, or bile, from the hepatocytes. So if you have a family of diseases which result in either the inability to transport conjugated bilirubin, either because of a cellular defect or a transportation defect, then you might wind up having bilirubin levels of 5 times normal, or, you know, if one is about your limit, here you have one that's 5. And of course, the baby may be jaundiced as well, possibly. So that's the so-called family of what Robbins calls metabolic liver diseases. I could show you a picture of alpha-1 antitrypsin here. It's kind of funny, but basically we go to the next slide and even show it to you bigger. Because if you look at the liver of a patient with alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, you see little destructive areas within these hepatocytes resulting from antitrypsin not being present in sufficient levels to regulate trypsin, and therefore the trypsin is actually doing destructive digestive changes within the liver, and it results in these little PAS positive inclusions. And it's not likely you really need to know this, but it's really one of the things that we look for when we know that the patient has a alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. They do a liver biopsy. That PAS stain is going to be ordered, and we're going to look for them. And if you ever see something as nice as this, you're going to feel like you really scored big. Okay, we're done with the liver, more or less. We can more or less go to the intrahepatic bile ducts now, which are technically part of the liver. And if you remember when we looked at our various normal and abnormal liver slides, we said that the only really true epithelial cells within the liver are in the bile ducts, the small ducts, the medium-sized ducts. And remember, that's ultimately an outpocketing of the entoderm of the foregut. So that same epithelium also lines not only the extrahepatic bile ducts, but also the gallbladder. The gallbladder can be thought of as a little cystic dilatation of this whole embryologic system here. So let's talk about some points here. The intrahepatic bile ducts are different from the extrahepatic bile ducts. The extrahepatic bile ducts are what you have found when you dissected out your liver and you saw the left and right main bile duct, you saw the common hepatic duct, you saw the cystic duct, you saw the common bile duct, and if you're lucky, you were possibly able to trace that all the way into the duodenum. Embryologically, they come from the same tissue. So if I was to ask you, would intrahepatic ductal disease, especially inflammatory diseases, be associated with extrahepatic ductal diseases also? And the answer is yes, because they come from the same embryologic area. But the intrahepatic are in the liver. You can't see those unless you do a microscopic exam of the liver. Now, there is an autoimmune disease with which we've mentioned 2 times already, in which your body makes antibodies to attack the intrahepatic bile ducts. So if you had a person that had primary biliary cirrhosis, PBC, that's the name of the disease, this person would wind up having antibodies, autoantibodies, which are attacking his intrahepatic bile ducts, causing an inflammatory reaction, and eventually leading to cirrhosis. So the cirrhotic nodules of primary biliary cirrhosis look almost, are very, very micronodular, and they look like they have come from the actual portal tracts. Now, you can also have a secondary biliary cirrhosis as well, and that's easy to understand. Because let's say you don't have a autoimmune or an intrinsic process attacking your intrahepatic bile ducts, but you have actual bacterial pathogens. And of course, you know where they're coming from, don't you? They're coming from the GI tract. They're ascending. They're ascending through the bile ducts. They're ascending into the liver. And these are the general gram negatives that we see infecting the urinary tract as well in an ascending manner. So if you had inflammation of these ducts strictly from either obstruction or bacterial infection, it would ultimately possibly if not corrected, cause a secondary biliary cirrhosis. So both primary, secondary, the auto primary disease, the autoimmune disease, and secondary, caused by either pathogens, bacterial pathogens, or obstruction, could be a cause of cirrhosis as well. Now, cholangitis is a term, a logical term, which describes inflammation of the intrahepatic bile ducts. So let's say that you're looking at a slice of the liver and everything looks normal. You see your portal areas, your central vein, your lobules, blah, blah, blah. But you see a lot of inflammation of the bile ducts in the portal areas and possibly even neutrophils within the actual ducts. Well, those may very likely be caused by the usual gram-negative rods that infect the lower urinary tract as well from an ascending route. And also, remember, in Crohn's disease, we have an idiopathic, and in ulcerative colitis, we have an idiopathic inflammation of the colonic mucosa. Well, are those colonic mucosal cells of the same embryologic derivation as the outpocketing called the biliary tract? Absolutely. So in Crohn's disease, you can have idiopathic inflammation of the bile ducts as well. In that case, you would not be able to culture out any type of organism. Okay, let's talk in general about some of the blood vessels of the liver now, the so-called circulatory disorders. We've touched on them briefly. We talked about edema. We've talked about a lot of things. But let's just say that the single most common vascular disease of the liver is passive congestion. It's also called passive hyperemia, by the way. And if you do a Google search, probably passive congestion is about 10 times more common than passive hyperemia. But it's caused by heart failure, because in heart failure, and especially right-sided heart failure, because the right side of the heart drains not only the caval circulation, but also the systemic. So if you have backup of fluid, of blood, because of a failing heart, especially right heart, you're going to get dilatation of the atria, the vena cava, and even all the way down into the hepatic veins, and even all the way down into the central veins. So, without a doubt, your patients that are in heart failure will probably have some degree of congestion in their liver. We talked about this before. Very, very common in CHF. But if that congestion is long-standing or severe enough, it could then cause actual necrosis in the central portion of the lobule where the central vein is. And that necrosis could eventually lead to cirrhosis, because remember, any long-standing untaken care of insult to the liver can lead ultimately to cirrhosis. And that's called cardiac cirrhosis. So that's an example of where a failing heart can cause a failing liver. Now, you know, there are a few rare anomalies and findings seen with the other vascular parts of the liver, the portal veins, the hepatic veins, even the inferior vena cava, the hepatic arteries, all of the anomalies that we have generally talked about with blood vessels in general, you can see in those as well. But without a doubt, chronic passive congestion is the single most common vascular liver disease. And I want you to take a little memory picture of this liver right now. And you know it's a liver, and also you know it's not normal. Take a look at this portal area. You know it's a portal area because you can see a vein, you could probably see some bile ducts, and here's a portal area here. Look at the hepatocytes around the portal area. They look viable, don't they? Look at the hepatocytes around this portal area. They look viable, don't they? So there is no periportal necrosis, is there? The necrosis is in the central vein area between the portal triads. In fact, the necrosis is so significant that it's very hard to recognize a central vein very much anymore. You see hemorrhage, you see granular junk. Here's an area here, here's an area here, here's probably an area here, here's an area here. So once again, when we talked about the general principle of all liver diseases, is that when anoxia, like with congestive heart failure, is the main problem, it's the central portion of the lobule that will become necrotic, because that's the last part of the lobule to receive oxygen. If it was primarily a toxic problem, then it's very possible that the periportal area would become necrotic, because of that's the first part to get the blood in the first part to get the toxic materials. That's a general principle that has a good number of exceptions, but if you could understand that, that's the third time that I said it, then you could really understand, you know, liver disease. It should be mentioned that in pregnancy there's a, you know, wide variety of problems with the liver. It's very, very common for a pregnant woman to develop a fatty liver. Of course, that could be reversible, like all fatty livers can be reversible, as long as they haven't gone on to cirrhosis. Cholestasis. Remember, we talked about the number one family of drugs causing cholestasis are steroids and female steroids, and it's not unusual to have cholestasis in a pregnant woman. And that's above and beyond the normal eclampsia that they could get, you know, in which are causing changes in the kidneys as well. People with transplants, not just liver transplants, not just a transplant that can fail by a host versus graft reaction, but it's also known that people that get bone marrow transplants or transplants of other organs, you know, like kidneys, for example, they will result as toxic effects on the liver or in a graft versus host reaction, like we get with bone marrow. You give a person a new bone marrow, some of those cells are going to want to attack the liver. You give a person a transplant of anything and you have to put them on immunosuppressives, some of those are hepatotoxic. So these are things that go without saying, but remember this again. You prescribe a drug, supposedly you have read the package insert, and if that package insert says get baseline hepatic enzymes, you know, transaminases or the membrane-bound enzymes, if the package insert recommends a baseline liver profile before you put the patient on that drug, then you know that that drug has been often indicted as being hepatotoxic. Okay, we're into the last category now for liver. We always talk about tumors at the end, and we generally start with benign tumors and then we go to malignant tumors. It's really hard to fully describe any truly clonal benign liver tumors. Now, there are things called hepatic adenomas, okay, and they are benign, usually well-limited growths of hepatic cells. But in almost all cases of hepatic adenomas, they also have another name. They're also called focal nodular hyperplasia. So I don't believe that these are truly clonal proliferations. Most of them are regarded as hyperplastic liver nodules. Now, I've probably been to about 20 conferences in pathology where somebody's showing a benign liver tumor or focal nodular hyperplasia. Well, in all of those 20 conferences I've been to, in every single case, the patient was on birth control pills. So, it's a disease of women, It's the disease of women who've been on birth control pills for a long period of time. Of course, they may not appear while they're on the medicine. They may appear years later. But almost all of the benign hepatic adenomas or focal nodular hyperplasias are linked to birth control pills. So that's one little thing you could remember. Another thing that you really don't have to remember, because it's logical itself, is that of the benign tumors of the liver that are not hepatocytic in origin, but they are vascular in origin, in other words, the angiomas, you can probably call those diseases of blood vessels rather than diseases of the liver, but they just happen to be of blood vessels within the liver. So that's why it's very hard to, after I look at this whole category of benign liver tumors, is to really point out a truly benign clonal proliferation of hepatocytes. Now, in the case of malignant liver tumors, it's very easy. 99% of the malignant liver tumors did not originate in the liver, but they are metastatic to the liver. Remember, the liver is the lymph node for the portal system, so any tumor of an organ that is supplied by portal vein will go to the liver quickly when it metastasizes. And any malignancy will eventually wind up in the liver, like in the lungs. So if you were to do a study of all of the organs in the body that are tumors, malignant tumors from anywhere, are most likely to metastasize to, most likely lung might be at the top of the list, but liver would be a close second. So when we do autopsies on patients that have had malignancies, we cut the liver very thin. You know, probably the CAT scanner or the MRI scanner can cut it even thinner. But if we find something, we can always take a section of it and prove that it's a metastasis rather than a cyst or a granuloma or whatever. Now, there's two kinds of primary liver tumors. Now remember, we said that at least in the United States, almost all the malignant tumors are metastatic. But the primary ones are either primary tumors of the hepatocytes or primary tumors of the glandular bile ducts. So a primary liver malignancy of hepatocytes is called hepatocellular carcinoma. It's also called hepatoma. They're identical. So just because hepatoma does not have the word carcinoma in it or sarcoma or anything like that, all hepatomas are malignant proliferations of hepatocytes. Okay, another thing to tell you is that all primary hepatomas rise in a background of cirrhosis. It is almost unconceivable to hear of a hepatoma arising in the liver that doesn't already have cirrhosis. So cirrhosis in itself is a, no matter what the cause is, and especially in some of the viral hepatitises that go into cirrhosis, like B and C, cirrhosis is regarded as the soil in which hepatomas grow. Now, what about cholangiocarcinomas? Well, you know that the bile ducts are the only parts of the liver that look glandular. So, if you have a primary malignancy of the liver, it's not from anywhere else, and it looks like adenocarcinoma, then you could bet that it's coming from the bile ducts. Why? Because there's no other part of the liver that looks glandular. That's why. So, if you see a liver that's filled with little nodules and you look at it and you see that it's adenocarcinoma, but you don't obviously see a primary coming from the colon, the stomach, the pancreas, or anywhere, you have to consider the fact that that's a primary cholangiocarcinoma. And of course there are markers that you could use to identify these glandular looking cells as being of bile duct origin rather than metastatic from somewhere else. Okay, what is this? Well, it's a tumor that's very well encapsulated. So already you're thinking it's benign. Let's say I told you this was part of the liver, or maybe protruding from the liver, maybe there's a little stalk. And when you look at the tumor itself, you're seeing spaces that do not look glandular, but they look like they're lined by an endothelium. And in addition, there's a lot of blood cells within these spaces. So this would be an extremely easy diagnosis of hepatic angioma. And the fact that it's encapsulated even supports the fact that it's benign more than by looking at the so-called benign array of these blood vessels. Okay, so that's a benign vascular tumor of the liver. Now, what is this? We saw this picture before once or twice. You know, we're in the autopsy room. I cut out the liver. I put a blindfold on you. Then I have you walk into the room and I say, feel this. Well, you have something in your hand that weighs about 1,500 grams or 2,000 grams, and you see that there's bumps on the surface, but there are also areas between the bumps that are very smooth, and some are bigger bumps and some are little bumps. You know, you don't need a degree in rocket science to figure out that this is metastatic adenocarcinoma. In fact, it can't really be anything else. It can't be cirrhosis, because cirrhosis would be diffusely nodular. And cirrhosis wouldn't have very, very large nodules and then tiny nodules necessarily. So that's the blind man's diagnosis of metastatic liver disease. On the other hand, let's say that we put that blindfold on you and you walked into the room, and this was the only area of the liver that you felt a big bump. When you rub your hand down the rest of this liver, it might be finally nodular, like maybe cirrhosis, but then you have a big nodule here. And mostly they're yellow, okay? Most of the hepatomas look yellow. They can look red if there's a lot of hemorrhage, or they can look gray if there's a lot of secondary fibrosis. But this is your classical appearance for a classical hepatocellular carcinoma. It's also called HCC. But I don't like that term because it, you know, makes you think that maybe it's from hepatitis C, so I don't like that term. But that's what everybody in Hong Kong was using in our conference last year. And remember, they're also called hepatomas as well. Now, here's another hepatoma. Here's a cut surface. Here's probably the cirrhotic background from which it grew. But look, it's basically only one big nodule. This nodule may occupy a good portion of the left lobe, but it's basically only one big nodule. So if you're feeling the cut surface of this liver, or just feeling it before it's cut, not only are you going to see that it's sort of yellow and it's basically one nodule, there may be some smaller nodules around it in the very close vicinity, but generally it's limited to one area. But look, here's a picture now of it. And, you know, I'm going to pop open the question box because I have to ask you a very, very important question, and you must be honest. Here's the question. Do these cells look like hepatocytes? Well, I'm seeing a lot of people saying yes. I saw one person that said no. And, you know, I'll respect whatever you say. But I can tell you, with all of the hepatocytes that we looked at, remember, we said they're small, round nuclei. They usually have a central nucleolus. And these look a lot like hepatocytes, except in some areas they may be very, very bizarre. And here, let me ask you one last question here. You see that little pigment there? And you see that little pigment there? And you see that little pigment there? What do you think that is? You think it's hemosiderin, bile, or melanin? Yeah, it's bile. It's probably bile, because the tumor can also compress and obstruct some of the local ducts as well. Now, if you're saying, well, maybe the tumor is hemorrhagic and maybe that's some hemosiderin, I'd say, well, maybe it is, but why don't you do a Prussian blue stain? If the Prussian blue stain did not show this pigment to be blue, then you know it's bile. Okay, here's a cholangiocarcinoma, and once again, it's a primary liver tumor. So it's more likely that you'll see a generally large single area where it started because it's primary. But you may also have a little stippling of nodules here. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, could this be maybe a metastasis from a colon cancer that had one big area but then a bunch of little ones around it? And I would say, well, it could be, but I haven't seen too many like that. Look how diffuse these little nodules are. So if you were to take a section through any of these, you would see something that looked like any old run-of-the-mill adenocarcinoma. So I will admit, if I showed this picture to any of my buddies here that have practiced pathology for 40 years, they'd probably say, this is an adenocarcinoma. But then I would say, oh, by the way, there's no known primary, and this is the liver. Then they would instantly say, well, yeah, it looks like a cholangiocarcinoma. I knew it all the time. So cholangiocarcinomas look exactly like metastatic adenocarcinomas. Now, there are antigens, you know, immunoperoxidase, you know, immunohistochemical antigens, IHC, that you could stain that proves these cells are of bile duct origin, you know, rather than colon or pancreas or, you know, lung or something like that. Okay, we are done with the intrahepatic bile ducts. Now let's go to the extrahepatic bile ducts, of which the gallbladder is one of them, isn't it? So let's talk about the most important extrahepatic bile duct, and that's the gallbladder. And this is a picture right from our virtual microscope, a nice capture. And if you remember, when you took histology 101 and somebody had to give you an example of non-stratified columnar epithelium or simple columnar epithelium, the gallbladder is probably the best organ in the world to demonstrate that, because look, all of these cells line up very, very, very nicely. And in addition, then there's some connective tissue underneath that. And you know what this pink stuff is. You know these pink cells with the elongated nuclei, smooth muscle. And very often, you might have a hard time differentiating a fibroblast from a smooth muscle cell. But look at the staining here. This is collagen. This is connective tissue. So these spindly cells here are, without a doubt, fibroblasts. But these spindly cells in the more pink fibers are smooth muscle nuclei. So if you do it to trichrome stain, all of this light or pink area would probably be green, but this brighter pink area would be negative because that's not collagen, that's smooth muscle. And then we have some connective tissue and maybe even fat in the outer layers. And if you see a nice thin nucleus here or here or here or here, you know these are mesothelial cells. These are cells of the visceral peritoneum, because the gallbladder is usually something that you could see in the abdominal cavity, so you know it has to be covered by serosa, except for the part, of course, that's plastered onto the liver, what they call the gallbladder fossa, and that part of the gallbladder wall, you wouldn't expect to see mesothelial cells. Okay, this is your classical gallbladder. Now, what are some of the diseases? Well, there's a few interesting anomalies we'll mention, but the two big gallbladder diseases are stones and inflammation. And then you could have some little cysts that develop, usually congenitally. And of course, you could have neoplasms, and you would probably think, well, if there's neoplasms and they're epithelial, they're probably coming from this epithelium here. They're probably adenocarcinomas, and you're absolutely right. But even though I'm going to mention a couple of anomalies and a couple of cysts, I want you to remember that the two main diseases are stones and inflammation. And furthermore, I want you to remember that each one is both a cause as well as an effect of the other one. So, do stones cause inflammation? Yes. Do inflammation cause stones? Yes. Is inflammation the result of stones? Yes. Is stones the result of inflammation? Yes. It's all possibilities. So if the stone is in the gallbladder, it's called cholelithiasis. If it's in an extra, if it's in the cystic duct, it's called choledocholithiasis. Of course, if the inflammation is in the gallbladder, it's called cholecystitis. If the inflammation is in the extrahepatic bile duct, it's called cholangitis, and that's to be differentiated from intrahepatic cholangitis. So those are the main considerations. And let's talk about some of the interesting anomalies. They're probably not surprising because almost every time we've described congenital anomalies, you probably thought it was logical in terms of remembering its embryologic course. So could you have a gallbladder that's absent because some reason it never just developed embryologically? Absolutely. It's not very common, but you could have congenitally absent gallbladders. Okay. Can you have some duplication of the ducts? Absolutely. You'd be amazed if there weren't duplications. Can you have a bilobed gallbladder? Well, if you have a bilobed uterus, you could probably have a bilobed gallbladder, and that occurs as well. Sometimes it's completely bilobed, or sometimes there's just a little cleft that sort of divides it into two areas. Could you have something called a Phrygian cap? You probably don't know what that is, but every pathologist in the world has probably never heard the word Phrygian unless he's talking about the gallbladder, even though the Phrygians were a group of people around 1000 AD who lived in Turkey. The Phrygian cap is what they wore. It looked like a little Where's Waldo cap, but the Phrygian cap is something that the gallbladder looks like. Could you have either hypoplasia or narrowing of this duct system, or could you have it completely absent? Could you have agenesis of the bile ducts? Yes. If you did, would it probably be incompatible with life? Yes. Could you have agenesis of the gallbladder? Yes. Would that be incompatible with life? Probably not. Okay. So, here's my interesting Phrygian cap. I did a little Google research on this, and I don't know how many of you are in Central Asia or near Turkey, and I know that if you were there 1,000 years ago, a lot of the people wore caps like this where the tip just gets kind of bent over. And this is what they call a Phrygian cap on the gallbladder, too, is where the very tip of it is kind of puckered in or bent over. And in this case, it looks like it's puckered because of a large stone. So this is a classical Phrygian cap gallbladder, and this is a classical Phrygian cap. And I don't think this guy is a real Phrygian because they were only around about 1,000 years ago. Okay, so much for the interesting anomalies. Let's talk about the two big diseases, stones and inflammation. There's two kinds of stones in the biliary system. The black or dark green ones are bilirubin, and the yellow ones are cholesterol. Now I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, aren't there any calcium stones? Yeah, there are, but they're not too common. I think the statistics will tell you that only about 10% of the stones in the gallbladder have significant calcium. They're either bilirubin or cholesterol. On the other hand, in the renal system, about 90% of the stones have calcium. The others have either uric acid or phosphates, in the gallbladder and bile system, the most common type of stone is a cholesterol stone. Where do they come from? Well, they come from the fact that sometimes the bile is just supersaturated with cholesterol, and therefore crystals form. And once these cholesterol crystal seeds form, they get bigger. And at some point, when they're very small, these tiny little cholesterol particles could be chewed up by macrophages, much in the same way cholesterol is chewed up by macrophages in atheromas of artery. Another factor for cholelithiasis, whether they're cholesterol or not, is hypomotility. If that bile isn't regularly under normal physiologic control, squeezing out bile all the time, and you have stasis of bile, you're much, much more likely to form a seed. Whereas even if you have a seed or a small stone, if that gallbladder is moving, that's going to be squeezed out, okay? It's only the large stones that cause clinical problems. Another factor is excess mucus. Normally, the gallbladder does not secrete too much mucus, but in conditions of inflammation, it responds by having sort of a mucus hyperplasia, and that's a factor for stones as well. So remember, here we have a case of inflammation causing stones, and as you would guess, those stones have also an irritating effect on the gallbladder mucosa, so now you have a case of stones causing inflammation. Probably when you were in anatomy lab and you were dissecting out your liver and gallbladder, I bet you that at least 10% of you, when you opened your gallbladder or more, found a stone. Or, and if the stones were yellow, of course, you know it's cholesterol, it can't be anything else. Or you have just may have seen yellow streaking. Okay, you may have seen yellow streaking on the mucosa, not actual stones, because these things are attached to the mucosa, and that's called cholesterolosis. So, cholesterolosis gives rise to cholesterol stones. Now, what if I was to tell you that this larger looking polypoid attachment to the mucosa here is also yellow, so you know it's cholesterol. But let's say it's not freely movable. Let's say it's still attached to the mucosa, just like these small cholesterol papillomas are. Well, that would deserve the name cholesterol papilloma. So you'll hear the term cholesterol papillomas with gallbladder simply because it's a bunch of these little cholesterol accumulations within the mucosa getting bigger where they're actually grossly visible as attached papillomas. Here's a microscopic view of cholesterolosis. And if you're thinking, well, this kind of looks like a normal gallbladder, but here, take a look at some of the tips of the mucosa here. They almost look papillary, don't they? These are these little yellow streaks. You see this little streak here? You see those yellow foamy cells in the tip of the mucosa? Well, that's one of these yellow dots over here. And if you look, it's not a stone, but it's actually macrophages chewing up cholesterol, just like in arteries. So all of these cells that are in the center of the papilla, of course these are the epithelial cells, these are the single non-stratified columnar epithelium, but all of these foamy white cells are cholesterol macrophages, and that's why the mucosa looks yellow. Now I want to tell you another little tip here, and you know, somebody might crucify me, but all of the factors, the genetic factors, the dietary factors that would predispose for cholesterol going into the gallbladder mucosa are probably very, very, very similar for cholesterol going into the arteries. So if you were to look at the people that get the most stones and the most cholesterolosis, if you look at where they live and what their diet is and what their lifestyle is, they're probably identical to the people that are at risk for atherosclerosis as well. So that's one way of remembering it. Here's another gallbladder. And can I ask a question? What are these stones? I guarantee you whatever you answer, you're going to be right. Because you have green or black on the inside, so you know that that's bilirubin, and then you have yellow on the outside, so that's cholesterol. This is a mixed stone, okay? Here's another stone. I want to ask you the same question. What are these stones made out of? Yeah, these are bile stones or bilirubin stones. There's no cholesterol here. And remember, once again, very few stones in the biliary tree or gallbladder are calcium, whereas it's just the opposite with the kidney. So we talked about stones, and we say that they could be predisposed towards cholecystitis, but let's talk about cholecystitis. It's a clinical disease. It's a disease in which you have fever, leukocytosis, right upper quadrant pain, very similar clinically to appendicitis, you know, on the other quadrant. Very often it gets triggered off by a fatty meal. Okay, It's associated with stones. It's associated with retention of bile, sluggishness of gallbladder motility. It could be subclinical, or it could produce a tremendous amount of pain. Okay? And just like with appendicitis, the gallbladder can also have neutrophils infiltrating throughout the entire wall, including the muscularis, with acute cholecystitis, or it could be chronic. It could be also subclinical. You can take a lot of people that have stones and you see they have cholecystitis and they claim that they never had any right upper quadrant pain in their life. Now, you know, these stones can be detected very easily with ultrasound. They really show up very nicely, very quickly. They can also be shown up very well with what they call a biliary scan. In the old days, they were called HIDA, H-I-D-A scans. But they're basically giving the patient a radioactive tracer that's supposed to follow the physiology of bile. So it goes into the blood, and then it gets taken up, it conjugated, it's supposed to go into the gallbladder. And of course, if it doesn't, if you know the patient has a gallbladder, but the gallbladder doesn't visualize, then you can assume that it doesn't visualize for functional reasons. Either it's inflamed or it's completely obstructed. And remember, it's only the large stones that obstruct. You have a stone that's only a couple of millimeters, it'll probably pass right through into the ampulla, and the patient will never even know it. I've even seen stones like about the size of almost a centimeter that can pass through the duct without a horrible symptom. But usually after about, 3, 4, 5 millimeters, you're probably going to have some symptoms there. So once again, they go hand in hand with stones. Stones cause cholecystitis. Cholecystitis causes stones. And you know when they get symptomatic, and especially if the patient has acute cholecystitis with all of the features so typical of acute inflammation, then most of the surgery that's done now is laparoscopic. They just put the tubes in there, and they don't. Very, very little gallbladder surgery now is done open. You know, and that has really resulted in a shortened length of stay. I told you we're going to talk about cysts, and we can tell you that little dilatations of the bile duct system are not uncommon. They're usually congenital. They call them choledochal cysts because they're dilatations, and they're usually seen in children, which means they are a result of an embryologic or developmental error in such that the cysts, the ducts are bigger than they should be. Last but not least, here's something we don't have to say a lot of words about, and that's adenocarcinoma of the gallbladder. And once again, as you know, the gallbladder is lined by a simple columnar epithelium. If you take all of the factors that we talked about many times by which normal columnar epithelium can be transformed into adenocarcinoma, then all of the epithelial malignancies of the gallbladder are adenocarcinomas. Technically, you could probably get a tumor of the smooth muscle or the fibrous tissue or the fat or the serosa, but those are very, very rare. So for all practical purposes, adenocarcinomas of the gallbladder would look like an adenocarcinoma of anything. It's just a bunch of irregular glands. And once again, if I show this picture to any one of my friends, they would just say adenocarcinoma. And then if I said, well, you know, this patient doesn't have a primary, but his gallbladder only is loaded with this, then they would say, well, it's probably a primary adenocarcinoma of the gallbladder. And then they would tend to order a bunch of stains that would try to prove that these malignant cells took up their antigens, took up stains, which would identify them as being of bile duct origin. Okay, folks, we're finished with liver and gallbladder. And of course, on the next day, or the next session, we're going to be doing the entire pancreas, by the way. We're going to do both pancreas lecture as well as pancreas lab on the same day. That's a rare event, but pancreas is the shortest chapter. So it's time we could take a 10-minute break now. And once again, I am going to look at my little answer box here, the question box, if any of you want to type in questions during the break. Otherwise, we're going to be listening to two more powerful songs by Celine. And remember, we're only doing two now because one of the songs is pretty long, about 5 or 6 minutes, so I don't want to take up too much valuable time. See you in 10 minutes, folks.
The whispers in the morning of lovers sleeping tight are rolling by like thunder now as I look in your eyes. I hold on to your and feel the truth you made. Your voice is warm and tender, love that I could not forsake, 'cause I'm your thank you. somebody loves you. It's no good unless he loves you. All the way. Happy to be near you when you need someone to cheer you. All the way.
Taller than the tallest tree is. That's how it's got. Deeper than the deep blue sea is. That's how deep it goes if it's real.
Once again, that's the only word I can say after the break. Probably the two most perfect voices of the last 100 years, Frank Sinatra and Celine Dion singing together. I don't know how Celine's voice sounded to you, but on my end, before I send it over to you on the internet, it sounds perfect. It's like they're sitting right next to me. Now, maybe by the time you get it, it's not totally perfect. Maybe it sounds good. But remember, the movies that I make are what I am experiencing. It's not what you're experiencing. So, most likely, if you go tonight to download this same video that you just attended live, you're probably going to say, oh my God, the music and sound and video is so much better. You know, I'm not trying to, you know, get rid of you as customers, but I'm just telling you the facts. I am just thrilled that my videos are actually better in quality than the online real-time webinars. Okay, last announcement is, you know, I live in a four-story townhome here in Lake Bluff, which is near Chicago, and there are smoke detectors by law on every floor. And not only are these smoke detectors wired into the house's electrical system, but you have to have batteries in them too, by law. So here I am, trying to get a good night's sleep before a class, and 2 a.m. I hear chirping, 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 chirping. Not only does it chirp on the floor where your batteries have died, but it also chirps on every floor. So here I am, 2 a.m, chirp, 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 no matter what floor I go to. I try to replace the batteries, if you could imagine, at 2 a.m, getting a ladder and going to my ceiling, and they're all replaced except for one. So they're still chirping, chirping, chirping. So I finally find a little corner of the first floor where the chirping is the least, and I'm able to get a couple of more hours sleep. So if it sounds like I am not 100% rested today, you know, that's my alibi, and I'm sticking to it. We're going to have a liver lab now, and the liver lab is going to cover the last 2 sessions of everything we talked about with liver. I've selected once again about, that looks like about 25 cases or so, of the best classical liver findings in relationship to normal histology. And I don't know if we'll be able to do all of them, but I'm going to try. But I've already selected and weeded out a lot of the exotic cases or the difficult cases. And I just want to show you the basics of a liver, both in terms of normal histology of liver and gallbladder, but also in the basic patterns of diseases which alter that histology. Because if you remember, Dr. Virchow says all diseases are alterations of histology. That's how us anatomic pathologists justify our existence. Here's a normal liver. And we don't have to spend a lot of time on it, but I want you to remember that when you order a liver biopsy for your patients, and let's say the liver is normal, the report's going to probably come back, and it's probably going to start out with something like the normal hexagonal portal architecture of the liver is preserved. Well, here's a liver, here's a portal area, you can see a big vessel, and here's one, here's 2 veins, here's one, there's a vein, an artery, and a duct. Here's a big one cut funny where you can see 2 of them again. Here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one. So you have to use a little bit of imagination. And even though we're not in high power, and we may not even go to high power, you have to remember that the portal areas are arranged like hexagons surrounding a central vein. And remember, it's these portal areas, you know, 20% arterial blood, 80% portal venous blood going through the sinusoids into the central veins. This is the so-called normal architecture. That's all you have to keep in mind, because all of the diseases you could think of are variations of that normal lobular architecture. See that hexagon here? That's a lobule. Do you see these 2 adjacent portal areas draining blood towards the central vein? That's what you call an asinus. So an asinus looks like it's about 1/6 of a lobule. But remember, in real life, you'll very, very rarely see a true hexagonal pattern. You may say 3 or 4. So you have to sort of fudge it a little bit. And I'm just going to go a little bit now into this lobule. And I think you could see that this is probably a central vein here. Maybe this is one here. And remember, the blood flow is from the portal area through the sinusoids into the central vein, ultimately into hepatic veins. And of course, the hepatic veins won't be surrounded by arteries or bile ducts, and then into the inferior vena cava. Keep that normal architecture in mind. Now look, there may be a little bit of connective tissue here in this portal triad. Here's a vein, here's a beautiful artery, there's a beautiful bile duct. There may be some fibroblasts in here as well, but look, all around it there are no fibroblasts. There's reticulin fibers, but no fibroblasts. And ladies and gentlemen, if you wanted to give out a Nobel Prize for the world's most beautiful portal triad, this is it. The big vein, the thick-walled artery, and the beautiful columnar gland. This is the same epithelium that lines the extrahepatic bile ducts as well as the gallbladder, and behaves similarly in terms of diseases. This is your normal liver. Now look, almost all the cells within the lobule here have nuclei which are round. Probably 90% of those cells have nuclei which are round. Most of them have nucleoli, if you cut them to the right. Those are all hepatocytes. But the spindly cells you see at the edge in the so-called space of Disse, or if you want to call it, or in the sinusoids, like there, these spindly cells there, that spindly cell there, that spindly cell there, oh, maybe a couple of others, like probably that one. Now, those are reticuloendothelial cells, also called Kupffer cells. And those clear spaces between the hepatocytes are your sinusoids. So keep that in mind. Now, let's go to another normal liver. And this happened to be one where they infused the patient with tiny little carbon particles. And remember, if you have little particles, like less than a micron, floating around in your blood, the liver is going to probably pick up about 85% of them. And so this is a really good example to show you how we can now delineate those Kupffer cells better. Because look, you see all these cells here that have these India ink particles? Those are macrophages. Those are Kupffer cells. So there's probably about 20 of them in this whole field. But look, the hepatocytes with the round nuclei, they don't pick up the pigment because they're not phagocytic. Look, this is probably a central vein over here. Here's the sinusoids going into it. But the reason why you can't see the nuclei of the Kupffer cells is these carbon particles are blocking it. So that's just, they give you a good idea for the so-called macrophages of the liver, the so-called Kupffer cells. Also, remember, we said it and we'll say it again, there are no fibroblasts in the lobule. There's only a few in the portal area. There are no fibroblasts. Well, if there's no fibroblasts, how do you hold the liver together? Well, the liver is held together delicately by a network of reticular or reticulin fibers. So all these little black lines here are reticulin. And look, you see the reticulin fibers here sort of at the opening of the central vein. Do you see a sinusoid there opening into the central vein? Do you see how most of these cells are round again? This is not an H&E stain. This is a reticulin stain. The liver has a very fine, delicate reticular network. And this is a beautiful reticulin stain. Okay, what else can we show you? Well, we can show you normal gallbladder too, even though we'll be talking about liver first probably. Here's a gallbladder. It's very boring. You got some fat in blood vessels in the peri-gallbladder connective tissue. It would be analogous to the serosa of a GI. Then you have your smooth muscle there in the wall. This is the stuff that contracts, obviously. And then you have a mucosa here. And the mucosa just has absolutely beautiful, simple columnar epithelium. Look at that. The nucleus at the base. A nice border here. Then you have some looser connective tissue right underneath that epithelium. And then bingo, you start to get these smooth muscle bundles. Now look at the cells in the mini papilla of the gallbladder. They're perhaps lymphocytes, maybe some fibroblasts, but you don't have too many foamy macrophages filled with cholesterol, do you? If you did, you could diagnose cholesterolosis. Okay, normal gallbladder. Here, we might as well go to the next one here. Now that we've got a good feel for normal. And once again, every time you look at a liver, every time, no matter what the circumstances are, you have to ask yourself the main question. Is the normal hexagonal portal architecture still basically there? Or is it gone? Well, what if I was to tell you that if we looked in every single one of these inflamed or infiltrated areas here, we would see a bile duct, a portal vein, probably a little hepatic artery. But if you look at the spacing of these, they're still basically sort of hexagonal, aren't they? So the answer is yes, it's preserved. But you know something funny is going on. Because even though it's preserved, these portal areas are totally infiltrated by inflammatory cells. And look, here, let me ask you this. What are all of these cells over here? Okay, well, somebody said lymphocytes or T cells. That's a good answer. What do you think all of these cells are over here, however? This is a really good thing. These are neutrophils. I could tell you that before even, because look at, these neutrophils are not as densely packed as the lymphocytes, because lymphocytes have minimal cytoplasm, so they look denser, and neutrophils have a lot of cytoplasm, so they don't look as dense as lymphocytes. And look, if you don't believe that, look, let's just zoom in a little bit. You see all these cells? They're lobulated. See that? There's a lobule, there's a lobule, there's a lobule, these are all neutrophils. This is acute inflammation in the tract of the in the portal tract. Now, let's take a look at this other area here where I said it was lymphocytes. And look, they're all round, there's minimal cytoplasm. So you have acute and chronic inflammation in the portal areas. Are you with me so far? Do you agree? So, why would you have acute and chronic inflammation? Well, we could talk about hepatitis, we could talk about one thing, but can I show you something that you should probably notice if you really want to be a good pathologist? You should be thorough. Do you see this little area up here? And I could show you probably in every single one of these inflamed portal areas, I could probably show you a bile duct. Oh, that's probably not the best one, but there's a lot of acute inflammation around that bile duct. Here, let's look at another one. I thought I had a good one. Maybe we got a good one here. I'm not sure. No, that's just a blurred area. I'm going to show you one more time. Okay, not only do you have a bile duct, but look, you have neutrophils within the bile duct. So, do you think that all of this inflammation, acute and chronic, in the portal area might be the result of these bile ducts being inflamed? Yeah, so what's your diagnosis? Cholangitis. Okay, now can I ask you this? If this was long-standing enough, and you wound up having a lot of fibrosis in this portal area, and the fibrosis was extensive to the point where it caused nodules, what would your diagnosis be? How about cirrhosis? But what kind of cirrhosis? How about secondary biliary cirrhosis? What if these neutrophils and inflammatory cells were there not because of a infectious organism, but because of autoantibodies? Then what would your diagnosis be? Primary biliary cirrhosis. Yeah, you got the idea. Thanks. This is really getting fun now. Let's go to the next case now. And this one was called cardiac cirrhosis. And now you're thinking, well, how could you have cardiac cirrhosis? Because the heart is one thing, as the liver is another thing. Well, you know this is liver, right? And you can see portal areas. Now, whether you decided whether the so-called portal areas are still hexagonally arranged or not, that's your own private opinion. But I want to show you something. If you call this and this a portal area, and we zoom in Tennessee over here, if you now see that in these portal areas you have fibrosis extending sort of or almost to other portal areas, then you'd probably want to call that cirrhosis. And in fact, it was called cirrhosis. And it's called cirrhosis because this is a person that had long-standing heart failure. This is a person that had necrosis in the central portion of the lobule, and that necrosis led to fibrosis, which extends and connects portal areas. Isn't that something? Well, somebody said, could there be hemochromatosis here too? Well, if I did a special iron stain that was loaded with iron, I would say yes, but I could tell you, I really don't see too much massive amount of pigment within the hepatocytes. Here, I'll blow this up. I think you could probably call this a little bit of hemosiderin, but take a look at the hepatocytes themselves. You think they have any pigment in them? I don't think so. But remember, one of the reasons for increased iron or hemosiderosis in the liver is chronic liver disease, okay? So this is cardiac cirrhosis. This is an example of a failing heart causing a failing liver. And by the way, if you weren't sure that this was fibrous tissue and you think it's just necrotic stuff because the central part of the lobule is necrotic, and you did a trichrome stain, and your trichrome stain showed a lot of greenness around here, then you know it's fibrosis and it's not just necrosis. Because remember, fibrosis and necrosis can look similar, but only one of them stains blue on the trichrome stain. Okay, cardiac cirrhosis. Last question. This is an important one. Would you say that this kind of cirrhosis, if I convinced you it was cirrhosis with all of this fibrosis in the nodules, do you think that these nodules are about the same size as lobules? Or do you think you could actually see those as big bulging nodules on autopsy? In other words, is this micronodular or macronodular cirrhosis? Yep, everybody got the right answer. It's micro. You probably can't see it with your naked eye or touch it. So it's micronodular cirrhosis. Next case is something that you could see the label on it, but I wish you wouldn't, because what I'm going to show you is going to stand out spectacularly. First of all, you can see it's staining a little bit redder than normal, but who cares? Maybe the tech was a little heavy on the eosinophil this morning. And you could see, what the hell is this smeared stuff? Is this some kind of artifact? Is this somebody that poured ink on this slide? Or, well, we know this is an artifact because it's a crack in the tissue. But, you know, what is this stuff here in here? Is it? Let's take a look and see what the hell it is. And you can tell it's a liver, right? Because these look like hepatocytes, right? But what is all of this dark pigment kind of filling up like a little lake here or a plug? And it's both in the portal areas and it's in the non-portal areas. Yeah, those are bile lakes, bile plugs. So what's your diagnosis? It's bile. It's cholestasis. Would this stain green on Prussian blue? Would it stain for melanin? No. If there was a bile stain, which of course there are, would it stain positive for bile stain? Absolutely. And look, not only is it here, but look, it's even between cells as well. Take a look at this. Remember I told you that if there's significant stasis, you'll see a little bit of the pigment between individual hepatocytes also, because that's where the canaliculi are. So all of these little black spots here are bile, tiny, tiny bile plugs. I guess you could call a lake and a plug about the same, but most people think the lakes are bigger than plugs. I would probably call these things here little plugs. Okay, we're going nicely, and I really hesitate showing you the next slide, so I won't, because there's something tricky about it. So here, let's go to this one here now. Can I ask you, what is the organ? Yeah, everybody knows it's a gallbladder. It's not a liver. And do you see the mucosa here? And you could see infiltrates of lymphocytes, not only in the mucosa, but probably in the muscle layers, and maybe even in the serosal and subserosal connective tissue. Look at there's. So you have a gallbladder in which you have infiltrates of lymphocytes in the mucosa, in the muscle, in the serosa. So even without going into high power, what do you want to call it? Yeah, it's chronic cholecystitis. Here, let's take a look here. Yeah, here we go. Here's some lymphocytes. These are mostly chronic inflammatory cells. Here you have them infiltrating. Look, there's even causing maybe even a little bit of ulceration of this otherwise perfectly normal, simple, columnar epithelium. Now, you know these cells down here are lymphocytes, right? But what if we look closely here and a lot of them were neutrophils? Yes, anything that causes inflammation increases the risk for stones. Anything that causes stones increases the risk for inflammation. Let's make this very simple. Here, let's zip in on this area a little bit more. They look like they're a mixture of both. You can see probably some eosinophils, like there and there. But you can see mostly, I think you see some neutrophils here too. Some of these cells look a little bit lobulated. So if you call this chronic cholecystitis and some hotshot came around and he said, hey, I think we should call this acute and chronic cholecystitis because we have more than a couple of neutrophils here. Would you say, okay, we'll call it acute and chronic cholecystitis? And yes, you would. And look how beautiful the epithelium is over here. And I'm going to show you one more thing on this. Is look, can you see that the inflammation is also in the serosa here? Here's the serosa. You could probably look at these individual mesothelial cells. You can see there's edema and hemorrhage here mostly. And I'm going to show you a nice area of chronic inflammatory cells within the serosa as well, or in here. There you go. What is this thing over here? Is this artery is so big, I would imagine it's probably a major branch of the cystic artery, don't you? Okay. It's a pretty big artery, as compared to this thing here, which is a very, very tiny artery. And you know, these wide open spaces here, and here, and here, and here are veins. Okay, let's go on. Chronic cholecystitis. If you saw a bunch of neutrophils, you could call it acute too. You know what? Maybe I'll show you this case at the end, but I don't like it. I should have not put that in there. Here's another case. And I think instantly you'll realize right now, this is liver. You could see the areas here that have more than just a vein, like an artery and a bile duct. That's probably a portal area or maybe a hepatic vein. Probably areas like this that have no connective tissue around them are either hepatic veins or central veins. But can I ask a question? Do you think that the so-called overall normal hexagonal architecture is preserved? Oh, thank you for saying yes, because you really have to use an imagination. You'll never see perfect hexagons, by the way, but they still use the term. Okay, so yeah, I was right. This is central vein. And what are all these vacuoles inside of the hepatocytes? Fat. So what's your diagnosis? Fat cells, fatty change, fatty metamorphosis, steatosis. If the vacuoles are smaller generally than the size of the cells, you want to call it microvesicular, that's absolutely correct. Can I ask you another question? If this was a patient that had glycogen storage disease, you know, we talked about the glycogen storage disease, enzyme deficiencies in which glycogen builds up in liver and heart and muscle, and you know that glycogen also washes out in the processing, could you be fooled perhaps that this was glycogen storage disease? Yeah, like Van Gierke's is a good example. That's one of them. Yeah, but in this case it's fat, okay? And can I ask you a question? If you cut this liver at autopsy with a knife, and then you looked at the surface of your knife, would you see little fat bead globules on your knife? And on the other hand, if you were not forced to wear gloves and you put your finger over the edge of this liver, which of course we all did in the old days, would your fingers feel greasy? Okay, yeah. Last question. I want you to give me a number between 0 and 100. Somebody knew I was going to ask it. What percentage of this liver is fat? Somebody said 30, some of them said 80, 75. Somebody said more than 50. We're going as high as 80. I don't know. I'm a kind of a simple guy. I would say 50, but who knows? It might be 80, it might be 30. At least we're all not saying 90 or 10, right? Okay, good. Let's go to the next case. Aha. Now, the two things that you have to see to diagnose hemochromatosis are, number one, tons of iron in the liver, and number two, especially if it's advanced, cirrhosis. So, let me ask you this. Even before we go on high power, would you say that the so-called normal hexagonal architecture is now replaced by generally irregular nodules surrounded by fibrous tissue? Absolutely. So we have cirrhosis, okay? Now, is it a micronodular cirrhosis? Yeah. Well, somebody says macro, but, you know, it all depends on whether you think you could feel these or not. I think it's micro, but, you know, some of these nodules are a little bigger than lobules, but most of them, in my opinion, are about the size of a lobule. Okay, so we know we have cirrhosis. That's the easy diagnosis. That's the blind man's diagnosis. But let's also look at the liver tissue between the fibrous bands. What do you think all of that pigment is, not just in the macrophages, but in the actual hepatocytes? What do you think that is? Well, it's a golden pigment. And you know, golden pigments are intrinsic pigments, and usually they are either bile, hemosiderin, or melanin. What if you thought this was bile and you did a bile stain? It would be negative. What if you thought this was some weird kind of melanin, which is inconceivable for melanin to be inside of hepatocytes? And melanin is either in macrophages or it's in malignant melanoma cells. But let's say you did a melanin stain, you know it would be negative. So let's say you do a Prussian blue stain. What do you think the color would be of all these lobules? It'd be as blue as hell, wouldn't it? And I'm going to just zoom in a little bit bigger on here, and you can see all of this pigment within the hepatocytes is hemosiderin. This is hemochromatosis. Cirrhosis plus hemosiderin inside of hepatocytes. That's the definition. It could be primary, or it could be secondary to hemolysis or iron overload. Okay, here's an interesting one. And I think I may have showed you this slide a while back, because we basically have two things here. I'm going to show you the redder stuff on the right, and I'm going to show you the bluer stuff on the left. So, let's go to the redder stuff first. And here's a good thing. We'll go through New England or Virginia over here. So, what's your diagnosis? Simple, easy diagnosis. Look at all that fibrous tissue. Look at all those irregular nodules. Easy, slam dunk, third grade diagnosis. And you know these are hepatocytes, because look, don't they look like hepatocytes? They're round, they have nucleoli, their nucleus is in the middle of the cell. Can I suggest that perhaps some of these hepatocytes might have a little bit bigger and darker nuclei than normal? So they're regenerating nodules. There's a lot of regeneration going on here. There's a lot of turnover. Do you remember when we talked about cancer, we said that there's two concepts. There's both the initiator, which is the carcinogen, and then there's the promoter, which is the hyperplastic effect. Well, when you have a lot of regenerating nodules, you have a promoter. So let's go to the other side of the slide. And let's go to this blue area. So you know all the way on the right side here you have a lot of cirrhosis. Now, can I ask you one question? What do you think is arising in this cirrhosis? Yeah, it's hepatocellular carcinoma. And whereas on the cirrhosis side, we said, well, maybe there's a couple nuclei there that look sort of big and dark. But take a look at this. take a look at these cells here. They still may look like hepatocytes, but these cells are as malignant as all hell. Okay, look how big they are. Look how some of them nuclear. This is a classic appearance of a hepatocellular carcinoma or hepatoma. Okay, I have to ask you an honest question, and don't answer it just because you want to look smart. Give me your honest answer. If I just showed you this tumor, could you believe they were derived from hepatocytes? Do they still have sort of a hepatocytic appearance? Yes or no? Well, I'm seeing a lot of yeses, and I'm seeing a couple of honest no's. So I appreciate both of them. And I can understand why the people said no also. They're being honest. And the people that said yes said thought they looked like hepatocytes. Okay, here's another really nice picture now. We talked about it today. It's a slide. We're in lab. We put the slide under the microscope. You can see it's a gallbladder. You can see there's probably some inflammation or at least hyperemia. But let's take a look at the mucosa. And I think I will ask you the question, does this mucosa have a little bit more of a papillary type a configuration than normal? Yes. And my final question is, what do you think all of those foamy cells are loading up the tip of the papilla? Foamy cells. What chemical? Yeah. So what's your diagnosis? Okay, cholesterolysis. You all got it right. Now, can I ask you this? Is this person likely to develop yellow stones? Absolutely. So this is classical cholesterolysis. And this is what one of those bright yellow dots looked like when we looked at cholesterolysis of the gallbladder. And can I ask you one more question? If this papilla was actually very, very enlarged, so it looked like a little polyp, would you call it a cholesterol papilloma? Absolutely. Okay, no reason to go into that any further. I got to show you this one because I don't think we'll be able to see everything. So let's skip the non-emergency ones. Okay, first of all, can I convince you it's liver already? Here, let me show you some hepatocytes. Okay, you know these are hepatocytes, so you know it's liver. Okay, so let me ask you this. Besides this liver, probably not sure whether you could say the actual portal architecture is preserved, but what is the one thing that you can say? What are all of these spaces here that have washed out centers? Yeah, so you have a bunch of fat in the liver. And in addition, it's not just still a normal liver. You don't really know whether this could be early cirrhosis, but it's more than just fat in the liver. Look, there's a lot of inflammatory changes too. Look at this. So yeah, there's a beginning of fibrosis, there's inflammatory cells here, there's a lot of fat. And can I ask you another question? Because I'm not going to have a hard time finding it. Let's zoom in on here a little bit more. Yeah, see this thing over here? What do you think that is? You see this thing over here? What do you think that is? You're absolutely right. This is Mallory bodies. You see this thing here? That's a Mallory body. You see this thing here? That's a Mallory body. So we have a liver. You're not really sure if it's really cirrhosis or not, but you see a lot of fat and you see Mallory bodies. So what's your diagnosis? This is alcoholic hepatitis. It's also called alcoholic liver disease. It could also be called steatohepatitis as well. But this is the bridge. It's not just regular old fatty liver like the alcoholics get, and it's not really cirrhosis. Okay, it's the middle portion. This is a liver that has fat, and there's a lot of damage to the hepatocytes, including the production of these Mallory bodies, or what they call alcoholic hyalin. Okay, they're actually precipitated proteins within the cell. I believe they're, oh, I don't know, I looked them up once, but these are classical Mallory bodies, and if you want to call this alcoholic hepatitis, that's the correct diagnosis. If you want to call it alcoholic liver disease, that's a correct diagnosis. If you want to say if it's an alcoholic halfway between fatty liver and cirrhosis, you can. Now, will a large number of this type of picture go into cirrhosis? Yeah, they're intermediate filaments. They're cytokeratin. Thank you very much. Yeah, this will eventually go into cirrhosis, possibly. Could it be reversible? If this patient stopped drinking, even though he's going into cirrhosis, if he stopped drinking, could he have a normal, healthy liver within a few months or years maybe? Absolutely. So remember, it's only when you get to cirrhosis that it becomes irreversible. Before you get to cirrhosis, everything is reversible. Okay, and once again, I think you'll agree that when you just look at the overall picture here, you're not really looking at nodules with a lot of fibrous bands between them. You're looking at liver disease that is inflamed and has fat, but it's not really nodular and fibrotic yet. And if you were to do a trichrome, oh, you might see a little bit of fibrosis extending from some of these portal areas, but it wouldn't extend to other portal areas, and it wouldn't create a nodular picture either. Okay. Somebody says, does steatosis always precede hepatitis and cirrhosis and alcoholism? Well, it usually precedes, yes, the answer is yes, it usually does. Now, let me tell you one more thing. Some people might have a hard time differentiating alcoholic hepatitis from viral hepatitis. What is the one thing on here that you almost never see in viral hepatitis? Fat. So if you see hepatitis has a lot of fat, and you're wondering whether it's caused by alcohol, if you're wondering if it's caused by viruses, it's caused by alcohol, because viral hepatitis does not have much or any fat. That's a little tip. Okay, let's move on. Yeah, let's look at this one. You could see the label on it. So, did I click it twice? Yeah, I did. So you know this is a kidney on the right, and you know it's a liver on the left. And the kidney looks like it's really, really inflamed. There's a lot of inflammatory cells, okay? And probably the liver doesn't look that great either, because if you look at the liver, which we're going to show you, oh, there's a lot of inflammation going on here, not only in portal tracts, but also in the sinusoids. Now, can I ask you a question? Usually, I've made the statement before that the viral hepatitises are often very difficult to differentiate from each other, okay? Some of the pros will say, oh yeah, I could tell a B from a C or an A or a D. But generally speaking, all the viral hepatitises look the same to usual people. However, what about when you see a viral hepatitis that has an intranuclear basophilic inclusion? What's your diagnosis? Yeah, CMV. Because CMV is the only viral disease, in fact it's a common herpes type virus, that causes basophilic intranuclear inclusions like you see here. Otherwise, most of the other viral inclusions with herpes simplex and herpes zoster, they're eosinophilic. And I bet you if we go to the kidney, which is also another common place for CMV to infect, that we'll see a bunch of these there as well. But that's a beautiful cell. I want you to remember it, because that's one of the rare cases, and not only can you tell this is a viral hepatitis, but you can also tell what the viral cause is. And once again, in this viral hepatitis you see here in the liver, how much of it is fat, by the way? Zero. So you know it's not an alcoholic hepatitis. Okay, let's get rid of that one now. And let's go to, oh, you're going to like this one. It's a liver. I think instantly you could see it's cirrhosis, right? Because you have all this fibrous tissue between nodules. not only are almost all of the nodules small, but almost all of the nodules are about the same size as portal areas. So what if I was to tell you that this cirrhosis, even though it's just a cirrhosis, it's fibrosis and nodules, but what if I was to tell you that this cirrhosis started out because of an inflammatory condition in the portal areas, which eventually became fibrotic and extended to other portal areas? What's your diagnosis? Biliary cirrhosis. And if it was a biliary cirrhosis caused by autoantibodies against the bile ducts, it's called primary biliary cirrhosis, or PBC. If you're a cool guy, you could just say PBC. But if this was a cirrhosis in which the bile ducts were inflamed with, let's say, E. coli from an ascending infection, then that would be secondary biliary cirrhosis. Okay, we're done. In this case, it's PBC. And I know that a lot of the liver pathologists would say, oh, I could tell it's PBC right away, you know. But if you said, well, you know, this guy was an alcoholic and he never had autoantibodies, then he would probably say, oh, well, I knew this was just regular old Latinx nutritional cirrhosis all the time. See, that's the way pathologists are. They never like to admit they're wrong. Okay. Here's another nice one. And it wouldn't be fair if I didn't show you this. You know it's liver. It looks like the overall architecture is preserved. But the first thing you're thinking is, where the hell are the sinusoids? I don't see any spaces. So let's zoom into a lobule area. Maybe there's a central vein over here and a portal area. Yeah, there's a portal area and that might be a central vein. What is all that pink stuff that seems to be filling up the sinusoids? Well, somebody said congestion. Somebody said blood. But here, can I really, really ask you an honest question? True, these are hepatocytes. But the stuff that's filling up, they don't look like blood cells, do they? They don't look like collagen either. In all honesty, all you could say is that they are hyalin. Could this be amyloidosis? It is amyloidosis. But to keep you honest, you have to say without the Congo red stain, all you could say is that this pink eosinophilic stuff is called hyalin. And one of the many, many causes of hyalin is amyloid. And this is amyloidosis of the liver. And we talked about amyloidosis already several times. So if you were to see a liver like this and you saw hyalinized area and you couldn't quite explain it, what stain would you order? Excuse me. Absolutely Congo red. Let's move on to our last case. I want to show you two cases now. No, maybe three more. We'll do them real quick. Okay, here's a liver. Here is probably a portal area, but this is the central portion of the lobule right here. So I'm going to zoom in to a central portion of the lobule. And I want to ask you a question. If the central, what is going on in the central portion of this lobule? What do you call this granular junk? It's more than congestion. It's chronic congestion because you have probably some hemosiderin macrophages, but it's also necrotic, isn't it? So we have central lobular necrosis. If this liver was congested for a long time because of right-sided heart failure, and you had not only deposition of blood and blood pigment, but hemosiderin, if it was long enough, it would become necrotic. So remember, ischemic, anoxic conditions cause necrosis in the central portion of the lobule because that's the last area to get blood, anatomically speaking. Now I'm going to show you another case. And here we have another liver. in which you could see probably some areas of necrosis again, but here, let's blow this up. The areas of necrosis are, look at, they're around portal areas. You see, there's a bile duct, there's necrosis around that portal area, there's necrosis around that portal area. Look at that central vein. It's not necrotic. Up here, this is basically a periportal necrosis. So, just as though central lobular necrosis is characteristic of ischemic injuries, periportal necrosis is characteristic of toxic injuries. Because remember, this is the first area to get oxygenated blood, but it's also the first area to get toxins. And please keep that principle in mind. And the person that said, wow, I want to congratulate you, because that's what I said the first time I realized it too. Here's the last case. And it's going to be a case from Rock Lab. So I didn't have the actual FPX file, so we're going to go online to look at this last case. And then we'll call it a day. And it is going to take a little bit longer to come online. Yeah, we'll probably see it in about 5 seconds, I think. And this is from the University of Iowa's virtual microscope. And I hope it pops open pretty soon. Yeah, it's going to get here. Here's the thumbnail. You can see it's still looking like sort of liver. You could also see the diagnosis, which, you know, is a necessary evil. But rather than just read the diagnosis, let's look at it and let's understand the diagnosis. Somebody just asked for my email. My email is minarsik@gmail.com. Okay, look. Here is normal liver on the right, and here is some kind of infiltration by irregular dark cells. Now, if you don't believe this is normal liver on the right, let us zip it up a little bit. And we'll zip it up even more. So it'll take a few seconds to focus. And yeah, you know that these are liver lobules here on the right. But on the left, you have what look like dark, haphazard, irregular glands infiltrating liver tissue. And here you have rather normal looking hepatic lobules. So, what's your diagnosis? Last case, you have to all get it right. Metastatic carcinoma to the liver. Now, whereas we said that hepatocellular carcinoma usually arises in a background of cirrhosis, do you think that this liver on the right is cirrhosis, or you think it's pretty normal looking liver? Yeah, so this is metastatic. Another reason why it's not a hepatoma is because I'm going to show you something here, which I think you'll understand right away. These are little glands. Hepatoma doesn't form little glands. Cholangiocarcinoma can form little glands, but hepatoma doesn't form little glands. And here, take a look. That's kind of an abortive-looking gland. That's kind of an irregular circular glandular structure. Some of these cells are sort of linear. So this is a poorly differentiated adenocarcinoma metastasizing to the liver. And remember, 99% of all the malignancies of the liver are metastatic. Is there anything else I want to say about this? Oh, yeah. There is one more thing I want to ask you about this case. Let's say that I told you that this liver had all of these malignant glands in it, but we can't find a primary anywhere. We did an autopsy. The colon is normal. The pancreas is normal. The stomach is normal. The lungs are normal. Everything is normal. So would you then entertain a possible diagnosis of cholangiocarcinoma? Yes. But let me tell you something. It's probably just as likely that this is metastatic than it's cholangio, because very often you can find metastases in organs like liver or lungs, and you never, ever, ever find the primary, even at autopsy. That's kind of scary, isn't it? So that'll end our discussion on liver lab. And let's see, I'll pop down the window so we have room to see the beautiful flowers again. I think I answered all your questions. The person asked me for my email. You know what that is. You know my website and everything. So I think we're going to end now because it is 11:04. And we'll end with the same beautiful voice that we started with. And it will be Celine Dion. And perhaps this is her most famous song of all. And I can see I'm still using up a lot of computer energy here, so that file won't delete very quickly. Okay, here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, see you in 46 hours. We'll do the entire pancreas, both lecture and lab, in one session next Thursday, 2 days from now, 46 hours. Rock on. Thank you. rock on, you buzzards.
The organizer